Hi, welcome to the Galt's Vaults. I'm Kevin MacLean, Museum Collections Technician at the Galt Museum and Archives in Lethbridge, Alberta. Today we're going to talk toys, specifically these toys, courtesy of one of our followers, Janae. So people call us all the time. We get over 100 calls a year, and it always starts with a pitch. And so the first words that are uttered by the caller are, I have an old, old, old. And sometimes those words are followed up with, and it's museum quality. So what is this museum quality? And more than that, what does museum quality mean? So in some cases, it can mean something entirely different to the caller and to the museum at the same time. And on other occasions, it can mean exactly the same thing. In the case of the museum, why is that? Well, that's because it's relative, and it's relative to the relationship, the specific relationship between the object and that particular donor. So take these two toys, for example. One is in mint condition. The other one obviously is not in mint condition. Both are considered museum quality, and that's because the outward appearance of both reflects the relationship between that the owner had with that specific item. So one toy was loved so much that the young boy had his parents actually hide it in their closet to protect it from damage, and the other one was loved so much, so intensely, so directly, for so long that it literally shouts, I'll be loved more than you ever will. If only. So in conclusion, do please continue to say museum quality when you call us, but don't think of it so much as the object being in mint or brand new condition, and think of it more in terms of its cultural quality, and that's its use as a tool to tell the collective story of place, which is Lethbridge in southwestern Alberta. So we're going to leave you with the words and memories of one of our toy donors, the donor of this piece here, which is Marg Oberg. And with that, thank you for tuning into Galt's Vaults. I'm Kevin MacLean. Be well, Lethbridge.
My grandparents gifted this to me at Christmas when I was 3 years old. It is a Mary Thought pumpkin head. They meant an awful lot to me because they were gifted by my grandparents. I spent many, many, many hours in their home. My mother worked out of our basement. She was a ceramics teacher. She was basically one of the few women in the early 50s that was earning an income. I had such a fondness for my grandparents, and they were only blocks away from our home, that I spent most of my days there. And it would have been purchased through Eaton's. Eaton's was the place to go.
Do you remember going to Eaton's and going and looking at their toys and seeing pumpkins?
My grandfather had retired in 1954, and I was his sidekick. My grandfather and I would cavort around wherever we could get into trouble. And Eaton's was a popular haunt. And of course, Christmas time, well, what do you take children to look at? And back in those days, Eaton's used to have a very, very nice Christmas window. I mean, Christmas was always a fascinating time for children, and Eaton's definitely helped out with getting the children hyped up.
Do you love them equally, or do you love one more than another?
So today is with us Kevin MacLean. He's leader of the collection management operations of the Galt Museum and Archives in Lethbridge in Alberta in Canada. The museum claims himself that it made oral history the cornerstone of the Galt's collection practices. And after reading your concept, I was almost wondering, why isn't everybody doing it this way, actually? I was quite fascinated. And yeah, please briefly describe your project.
Yeah, so I would say that it's less of a project and more of a program. And that would be the way in which we go about our object research here at the Galt Museum and Archives. So there's two beliefs that would be at its core. And number one would be that the connections and meanings that our objects have, the relationships that they have with people are what make them unique and distinctive to us as a community, because most of what we have here is our settler colonial type objects. And it's those meanings and connections and relationships that are in our opinion, more fragile than the physical tangible object itself, because it's the relationships that are distinctive and unique. And the second thing is that we don't think that museums are its objects' authorities. We think that the authorities
behind our objects are the people whose lives are attached to them, who had relationships with them, who use them, who own them. They're in fact the authorities. So it's something that took place over quite a long period of time, and whether or not it's a good thing or not, I've been here for a very long period of time, almost 30 years. And in that time, I had the privilege to interact with quite a few people. And sadly, over that time, I would be taking people for granted. I would think that I always have access to them, but I would learn sadly that I don't, that we're losing people all of the time. And so when we're not taking advantage of that privilege, what happens is we're not doing justice to them. We're not doing justice to our objects, and we're not doing justice to our communities. Because it's our communities that cultural resource exists for. And so the other thing that we learned was that where we are collecting information about our objects, about the relationships between people and objects, that there's an expectation by our communities that we share. So I think it was back in approximately 2013 that the Museum Association in Nova Scotia told us that where we're repositories of information about what we have, that there's an expectation that we'd be sharing that too. So not only were we starting to think that our people were fragile, that we need to be engaging them more, we need to be recording more about why things were important to them, but that when we have this repository of information, we also need to be sharing it. The good thing that was also happening, I guess, over the past 20 years, 15 years especially, is that technology has been improving. And so our ability to engage with people has become easier with technology, and then also about storing and sharing information. And then finally, where we're thinking about the people that we're interacting with in the present differently, we also started to think that we have legacy collections that are here at the Galt, and that we owe it to those collections and those people that have relationships with them to go back and re-engage with them to try and correct the record as well. So where we didn't solicit and capture enough information, connections, meanings, relationships, we made a new effort to do that again. And in a lot of cases, we remedied those objects' contexts. So that's more or less. And it was an evolution. It wasn't something that was just a light bulb and it all changed at the same time. It probably changed over the course of 8 years. And we started to really wrap our heads around things in 2013.
Yes, I think so. You already taught us a lot about the history of the project or of the program, really, and I think we really see how this can only come about if you work on this for a while and make your experiences. And yeah, this is quite obvious, I think. What do you think were the particular qualities or innovations that the prize jury found so impressive about the project?
Well, I mean, maybe like yourself, that maybe they weren't aware of other institutions doing what we were doing, or at least to the extent that we were doing it. So they found that it was quite innovative. And not only would it be innovative, we think in our opinion, and maybe they did too, that it's quite easy to adopt either all of our program and our methods or even components of it. And it doesn't matter if you're a small institution or a large institution, we think that our methodology and our program would be accessible to lots of different people. It's very conversation-based. So we don't have high expectations of the people who have relationships with their objects in terms of asking them to do things with us outside of sitting across the table from us and having a conversation about why these things that they have are so important to them. And because it's organic, such as it is, and it's a conversation, that allows us to do deep dives into things where if we just ask static questions and they were giving us back static answers as part of a questionnaire sheet or something, it wouldn't have that same level of engagement as a conversation would. So it's easy for the folks that we're talking to. And the other thing that hopefully they saw too is that we're actually elevating people. So we're not elevating ourselves as an institution. What we're doing is elevating others by allowing them to speak on behalf of their objects directly to the people that are interested in those objects. And we think because of that, what we have and what we share is much more authentic as opposed to us speaking on behalf of other people's things. And finally, I think it makes our job easier too. So where we have this cultural resource that isn't just tangible and physical, but it's also intangible, it allows for us to provide doorways and windows into our objects that wouldn't otherwise exist, because other people visiting us can connect with that material culture themselves, and they can personally see that as their own story as part of other people's stories too.
Yeah, actually, I like the idea of empowering people, or I think this is really, really nice idea. What were the difficulties and positive experiences you had during the project? I'm sure there are many, but maybe some you can tell us.
Yeah, so I mean, it's significantly more positive than negative, and I can only think of one negative thing. But on the positive side, for folks like myself that get to do the work, there's immense personal reward and satisfaction that comes with engaging deeply with people. I think most of the time, folks don't feel listened to when they have conversations with others over the course of the day. And when we're having this open conversation with someone where there's no preset questions, none, our questions are based on the last answer that was shared with us, then people feel as though they feel a level of connection that they don't otherwise get over the course of their day. So that makes us feel good because we can sense that they feel good. And the work that we're doing lives on indefinitely beyond us. And so we feel some reward that we got to share time with people. And also that record gets to live on indefinitely into the future. And we especially feel that when we lose people and we see that that person's been lost. And that's also equally, I mean, for their families, that record exists. So it's extraordinarily meaningful. I think to the people that we're engaging with, they tell us they love us. I've been hugged before. It's meaningful to us too, because we think we're making a difference, not just in their lives, but in the lives of our community. Finally, the only negative thing that I can think about is that when our tech fails. And so if you do something on any scale and you do it enough times, at some point, it's going to fail. And when it does, and you've had a really good interview, you can never replace that moment. You can try, but you'll never get it back again in the same way. And it's almost like you've been hit in the stomach and it hurts and it wrecks your day. Maybe it wrecks your week. And all you can do is try again and get that next great interview to feel as though what you're doing is worthwhile.
So what is actually the first question you ask, or how do you start an interview? How does it begin?
Yeah, so there might be one or two questions that I use just as a kickoff. And so those questions could be, what is it at this particular moment in time that makes you want to give this object up? I'll often start with that one. And then the other one, which I'm trying to think of all of a sudden off the top of my head. Yeah, that's the main one that I always kick off with. And then as a result of their answer, I'm already thinking of my next question. So it's very, very organic.
Are there any stories related to you on one of the objects that were especially impressive for you?
You know, in 2013, we had somebody visiting us from the United States. And so up until that point in time, our interviews were selective. So we were making choices based on our perceived notion of heritage value, cultural value around that object and the person, whether or not we did an interview. And what she did is she humbled us. So that was the late June Manchak. And she was donating pillowcases to us that I have to confess, I'm not personally passionate about pillowcases, despite their being embroidered. But I recognized that she had traveled some way to be here. And so we did an interview with her. And the interview result was profound. It was revelatory insofar as the passion, the emotional response that we got from her over pillowcases. We weren't expecting it. And so that led us to think that every single belonging object item that is a possession has the potential to provide us with that kind of response. And so after that, we stopped being selective about our interviews and who we were going to do them with and around what objects. We did them with absolutely everyone who was going to give us material culture. Everyone got an interview. And we've been doing that in the time since. And we recorded, I think, approximately, well, it's over 1.2 million words now on our object collection.
Yeah. I think your project largely depends on volunteer work. And, you know, from practice, I know that sometimes it's difficult to find volunteers and also to keep them on the road. So what are you doing that those volunteers are doing it and keeping doing it?
Yeah. So what our volunteers do is they're transcribing these interviews, because, I mean, it's one thing to have the record, but it's another thing for it to be accessible for our institution staff and also for our users and for our community, because we're taking those transcriptions, in some cases verbatim, because that's the voice of the person. And we're putting them into our catalog records so that our records are actually speaking to the user. So the volunteers are doing that work. At least one of them has been here doing that for 25 years. Another couple of them have been doing it for between 15 and 20 years. And again, it goes back to what I said for myself personally and for the staff, is that I think the immense personal reward comes from conducting that work and knowing that you're making a difference, and also having an interest in another person's story that's told by their voice and not, you know, by someone else. They're telling it themselves. And where they're so passionate about something, because they've brought us something, that is naturally part of that conversation.
I think what you're producing there now is a very interesting source of yeah, local history, actually. Not only local history, because it's so really such so innovative, it's probably even interesting for people outside Canada, what you are doing there. Is there any research planned? Do you have corporations with the universities or something to do research on this body of sources that you collect there?
So not yet, sadly. And I don't know if it's a chicken and egg aspect. After 30 years, my feeling, and it's mostly envy, is that folks doing research on community history or some place naturally gravitate to archives, because the records that are held within that are much more accessible. So I say it's like a tree with fruit, and the easiest fruit to pick is the archives fruit. It's at the bottom of the tree, because to date, much of the tangible objects and belongings and items have not had that same accessibility in terms of their context, their connections, their meanings. We have to do that. We have to be active about it. And so maybe once people start to feel that objects, belongings, items can be as, if not more, informing about a place on a particular subject, will things start to change? Mm-hmm. So, and we haven't been very good at that. We've been bad, really bad, either because we've been focused solely on the physical and the tangible and not the person, or because we've taken them for granted. We haven't written down what they've told us. We haven't engaged with them properly. So we're trying to change that.
I guess there's really a body of sources you have there that could maybe change our perception of what is important in history. You know, I mean, our professional perspective, if ordinary people are asked and tell us what's important for them. And I think this is, I mean, that you can do any kind of academic work on this on a very high theoretical level if you want, or of course on the yeah, simple local history level. So I think it's really, really interesting. I would like to, at one point in time, read something about this, that maybe you find something, somebody who is interested in it. So thank you very much for introducing your really interesting program to us, and go on with that. I think really, I still wonder why not everybody is doing such a thing. In a way, it's so simple and it's so effective. And yeah, thanks a lot, and see you.
You're welcome, Jens.
The book.